Welcome to the ACS Technical Advisory Board podcast series, where we talk all things tech, including data, cyber, AI, blockchain, and Internet of Things. Meet your host, Dr. David Cook, Vice President of the Australian Computer Society's Technical Boards. David is a technology advocate dedicated to advances and progression of computing and human-computer interaction. In this episode, David will be chatting with Professor Toby Walsh about the light and dark sides of AI, along with how its effects and outcomes impact us all, even if we don't know it yet.
Today, we're going to talk to Professor Toby Walsh. Toby Walsh has two claims to fame. He is the chief scientist at the University of New South Wales AI Institute, and he's Australia's leading AI professional who has been banned from Russia. Toby Walsh, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
Let's talk about the dark side of AI. Are you concerned about the ability or the loss of control that AI brings to the space?
I have both optimistic and pessimistic views. It's a technology that's going to bring much into our lives, but equally, like any technology, you've got to think about the downsides, that there will be some dark sides to it. The way it's going to change our information sphere, the fact that you're not going to be able to believe anything you see anymore because it might be synthetic, made by artificial intelligence, the impact it's going to have on work, the way it's going to change the nature of our jobs. There's some things to be worried about along with all those positives.
So is it important that we advance that conversation on what kind of level? Is it an intellectual one which is going out to people who are making key decisions, or is it something that the wider community should know about?
Oh, it really has to involve everyone. This is a technology that's going to touch all our lives. It's going to be as transformative as the internet, perhaps as transformative as electricity. And it's impossible to imagine our lives today without those technologies. And similarly, in 5 or 10 years' time, it's going to be impossible to imagine what our lives were like without artificial intelligence. And so since it's going to touch all of our lives and it's going to impact all of our lives, all of us need to be involved in those conversations to think about where exactly it should be let into our lives and also where it shouldn't. I mean, there are many technologies where they're not going to advance our lives. They're actually going to hurt our lives. I mean, the really delicate questions about its use in the judiciary, its use for surveillance, its use in warfare, where I think we really need to have serious conversations about exactly what sort of guardrails do we need to put in place.
If only someone wrote a book about this. Have you ever thought about doing something like that?
Well, funnily enough, I have just written a book about it called Faking It, Artificial Intelligence in a Human World, which does look at some of those dark sides that you mentioned. In particular, it looks at the fact that we're going to increasingly be confronted by fake AI and AI fakes that are going to be deceiving us. And what sort of world is it going to be in which anything you see, anything you hear, you have to entertain the idea that it was synthetic, it was made by AI, it's fooling you. What sort of world is that in which, you know, the difference between truth and untruth is so blurred? How are we going to navigate that world? What is that world going to look by? And how do we ensure that that it doesn't, for example, hurt our democratic discourse, because social media is not particularly at the moment seemingly helping us, our political discourse, it seems to me.
I guess when we talk about things like information warfare, we start to see the really dark side of things and how it affects hostilities. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Yes. I mean, this is one area that does really worry me, the way that AI is transforming warfare. I'm pretty sure that historians of war will look back at the Ukrainian conflict and say, oh, that was one of those step changes, just as they look back at the Second World War and when we invented long-range bombers and the nuclear bomb, and that changed the way that we could fight war, just as they look back at the First World War and we invented tanks and machine guns, and that was a change to the way we fight war. Well, if you look at what's happening in Ukraine today, we see autonomous drones, both in the air and on the sea, being used and transforming the way, the speed, the character of war. And I'm not sure that's going to be a good thing.
So let's talk about the more optimistic side of things. What do we see? What do we have in store for us in terms of AI that's good?
Oh, I mean, we're all going to have our own personal lawyer, doctor, accountant, that and tutor that's going to be able to help navigate us. I mean, there's a wonderful saying attributed to Val Harian, the chief economist at Google, which is, if you want to imagine the future, imagine what, you know, rich people have today. You know, rich people have their own personal bankers, their own personal drivers, their own personal assistants that do stuff for them. Well, that's the benefit that AI is going to bring for all of us. We're going to have our own digital personal assistants that can go and, you know, help manage our lives, our own personal bankers that can manage our much more modest amounts of money, our own personal drivers that are going to drive our cars autonomously. So, yes, I think the opportunities are fantastic, and the way it's going to transform healthcare, the way it's going to transform education, and the way it's going to transform work are going to be really positive. And we're already starting to see that. This is not the future. This is now. The latest antibiotic was discovered not by humans, but by machine learning. We're running out of antibiotics. We're still prescribing the same antibiotics that we prescribed back in the 1940s, penicillin, the first antibiotic we ever discovered. And unfortunately, we're over-prescribing those antibiotics, and we're getting drug-resistant bacteria. And so we need to discover new antibiotics, and humans are not discovering them quickly enough. Fortunately for us, machines are starting to step in and do that. And what's exciting about this latest antibiotic is that it works in a completely different way to existing antibiotics. So it's in clinical trials at the moment, but the expectation is that those drug-resistant bacteria are not going to be drug-resistant to this new action that this new antibiotic has.
This wouldn't be much of a podcast if I didn't ask you about generative AI. So let's start by asking you the question, what are some of the more problematic aspects of generative AI?
Well, the most problematic aspect is its ability to create deep fakes. We can synthesize not just images, that picture of the Pope in a puffer jacket, not real, created by AI, synthetic text that looks like human text, but also synthetic voices. I only need a few seconds of your voice and I can clone it. And we're already seeing people using that for mischievous ends. We've seen two, we know of at least, two banks that have been robbed by people cloning voices, ringing up the bank and pretending to be the CEO of a company, acquiring another business and saying, you know, the next person on the line is going to be my lawyer who's going to give you the coordinates to transfer $35 million. That were stolen out of a Dubai bank.
So I suppose the flip side is generative AI worth it? I mean, what are the good things and do they outweigh those darker issues?
Oh, it's, yes. I mean, the impact it's going to have on business, it offers, you know, something over the roundabout 15% productivity boost for many businesses. It's a pity that we called it generative AI. Because that focuses people's idea on the way it can generate stuff. And it can generate stuff. It can generate images, as we talked about. It can generate audio. It can generate paragraphs of convincing text. But actually, I think a much more important, much more useful capability that it has is its ability to summarize and its ability to synthesize information together. It's really good. You know, you can give it a 70,000-page book and ask, well, what is the story in this book? Or give it a manual and ask it for a question about that manual. And if you think about it, many of us are knowledge workers, and much of what we do all day is summarizing and synthesizing information. And now we've got a tool that allows us to do that much more efficiently.
So I guess it's one thing to look at things from an Australian perspective, but I'm interested in the global side of things. Now, I understand that there is an international safety summit coming up in the UK. Is that going to be useful for us?
There's two sides to this. The one is the near-term risks, and then the other is the long-term risks. And I think it's really important that we talk about these near-term risks, that we, in some sense, missed the boat with social media. We only discovered after the event that social media was bringing some harms along with the benefits. And we need to have those same sorts of conversations about artificial intelligence. This safety summit is also there thinking about some of the longer term, might be existential risks. And I think there, the risks are very vague and they're very far in the future. And ones that the AI community is quite divided on. I don't actually think there's, you know, these are interesting, powerful tools that we're developing. But any risks really come down to people misusing those tools. And that's the same with any technology. They amplify what people can do. But if you trace it back, ultimately, there's a malevolent person at the end of it, the person who's putting this tool to misuse. And so we've got lots of ways of trying to ensure that malevolent people don't do any harm. And, okay, we've got to be careful that these technologies can amplify the harms that those people can do. But I don't think this takes us to a new place. I mean, there are real existential risks that face the planet, the climate emergency. We still, the threat of nuclear war. I mean, let's not underestimate the seriousness of what's happening in the Ukraine and the Middle East. Those are potential conflicts that could really cause significant harm to the planet as a whole. And I don't think AI fits into the same bucket.
Toby Walsh, thank you for your time today.
My pleasure.
To find out more about how the ACS is powering Australia's technology brilliance, visit us at our website, Facebook or LinkedIn. Want to get involved with the ACS technical boards? Email us at tab@acs.org.au and tell us a bit about yourself. Join us for more thought leadership, ideas, and information through our other podcasts on the ACS YouTube, Facebook, or on LinkedIn.